How do you get started with DSA and tell me your own journey with data structures and algorithms? How has your experience been like so far working at Microsoft?
Oh, it's pretty good. Like, it's one of the best experience so far, like, after college.
Hey, welcome back everyone. I'm Ishan Sharma. And in today's episode with me, I have Rohan Prasad to share his amazing journey from a tier 3 college all the way to being a UI UX consultant at Microsoft. Yes, you heard me right. This is going to be a very important episode for all of you to watch and to understand and to take away some key insights. Okay. The most important questions that you've always been asking me about placements, like how to get started with data structures and algorithms, how to get started with competitive coding, how to improve your ranks in competitive coding, and how to prepare for interviews. All of these things have been covered in this interview. I hope you'll enjoy this video. Make sure that you share this video with a friend of yours and make sure that you subscribe to this channel, like this video, and let me know in the comment section below what do you think of this interview. I really had a lot of fun and you too will learn a lot from this episode. And with that said, let's get started with this interview. Hey, welcome back everyone. I'm Ishan Sharma and welcome back to another podcast episode. And with me today, I have Rohan to share his journey to Microsoft. So first of all, Rohan, thank you so much for joining me here and welcome to the channel.
Hey, Ishan, thank you so much. Thanks for having me. You're really doing a great job, man. Keep doing it. This is helping lots of people. And
my pleasure. All right. So let's just quickly jump into some questions. I just want to, first of all, learn from you. How was the interview process like? And was it an on-campus interview or was it an off-campus interview?
Yeah, for us, it was totally on campus. Okay. So it starts with that test, online test. So it happens for 1.5 hour or 2 hour. It depends. Everybody have different sets. So what they usually ask in there is it's totally computer fundamentals. And again, they have coding rounds where they ask DS and algorithms. Mm-hmm. So this was the first round. So people cracking it. So there were lots of people. So it's a bar raiser round. So they this rounds reject so many candidates. Actually applying is like 100%. And nearly 80% of the people are rejected in this. Mm-hmm. Then again, if you crack this, you move on to interview rounds. So that is totally in person. Yeah. It's not happening now, but for our terms, there was no COVID and this also, mm-hmm. Everything was on campus.
Yeah.
So the first round was a technical round. So in technical, it was purely based on DSA. Again, apart from DSA, computer fundamentals, there are various subjects like DBMS and operating systems, and along with the data structure and algorithms. Apart from that, one thing is projects. They heavily rely on projects and also internships and trainings. So internship and training are very important thing. So this was the thing that was tested in, first round. So again, moving to the second round, they test on your managerial skills as well.
Okay.
So how you will be able to cope up with things like, project pressure, and deadlines and this all, like you can deliver it on time or not.
Yeah.
So there are lots of thing happens in projects. So they test on that. Suppose give you an example. So suppose you have a team of 5 members and one member gets sick before 4 to 5 days before the delivery, right? So how you'll be able to synchronize your team to with the left 4 people to give that project in time. So that is one thing that kind of question they ask. Again,
okay.
It's not fully managerial. They also put technical and they correlated technical and managerial skill as well. Then again, if you crack that, you move on to the last round. For us, it was last round. And I don't know, everybody have different set. And they not only judge on you, like you know things or you don't know things. They also judge you like you will be able to learn or not. So.
Okay. How flexible you are with learning new things, right?
Yeah. It's definitely.
Okay.
So it's not just, everything. Okay. You know, web development, I will put you in web development and you will do web development for the next 10 years and 12 in my company. So it's not like that, because technology comes and go, right? So It's about learning. So they ask that question and they are very experienced people, right? To judge you and to, you know, get most out of you, what you know and you what you don't. So they test very nicely and they, you know, get most out of you, what you know and what you don't know. So they ask question like that. And for the last round, it was totally based on my resume. Like they started with the top and reached to bottom, including my references, why you give these people as your reference. Have you worked on like with him or like in some projects or not? Something like this. Like, so it was total of 3 rounds and each round took around half an hour to 1 hour. Like it was the time range. Yeah.
And what is the difference between a UI UX role and that of a software developer role?
Yeah, this is a very
because this is something different yeah. Because generally people hear roles for SDE, right?
Yep.
And you have gotten a job role as a UI developer.
Yeah, yeah. So if you go to, you know, search engine Google or Bing anything, you search like different between UI developer and software developer engineer. So you won't find any concrete blog or, you know, article about it. So it's a pretty much like debatable topic, but for according to my perspective, I like to keep it this way. For software developer, like they like don't think like much of to the user side. So for example, as a UX engineer, suppose you are building a front end of a website. So we think like things like accessibility. If somebody is like not able to see, if somebody is not able to hear, if anybody, you know, having some color blindness sort of thing, how they are gonna interact with things, then comes responsiveness. Yeah. So it's not about the websites running on laptop or phone. It's about like running on smartwatches nowadays. It's about running on
making
like,
it responsive. You know,
making it responsive. Then there are various things we will look into it, like accessibility, responsiveness. There is something known as RTL, if you know, like left to right and left to right to left. So there are various countries where that things. So we look into like pixel perfect things. And as a UX designer, so in my team there are various well experienced UX designer. So what they do is they like talk to the people who are going to use it. So there are various terms in, you know, this UX field. So one of them is usability testing. So if people hearing us who are in UX, so there is usability testing. So why do you think like, you know, this Zoom button is here? There is a share screen button right here.
Yeah.
Why it is placed there only? Why it is not inside a top down clicking on the top right
more
bar?
Accessible.
More accessible. So these are the things, and these are not just created within one day, right? These are created first design, then they are tested with the user who are going to use it. They are finding good or not. So these are things like UX designer or UX developer look into this, how it is more accessible to the user. Whereas software development, if you go to software development field, they are more kind of, you know, there is a database, you want to fetch details.
More how logical part of it.
Yeah, logical part of it. But again, there are companies who hire people as a software developer, then they divide them into backend and frontend, and they do their kind of its work. But the title role is software developer engineer only, right?
Okay.
And there are companies who like specifically hire for UX engineer or backend engineer, like something like that.
All
I hope like this is clear, but I don't.
Yeah. That was clear. I actually took a course on Coursera on you know, UI and UX, and that was quite interesting. So yeah. All right. Let's get on to the most important and most frequently asked questions that people ask, and that's, how do you get started with DSA? And tell me your own journey with data structures and algorithms.
So there are two aspects of it, right? One, you are in already a computer science branch, and if you are not in computer science branch, so first let's take in computer science branch. I was from computer science background, but it doesn't separate like you from other branches getting into this computer science fields, right? So the first thing is, while you're in computer science background field, there are, or IT, there are other branches as well, IT. So in majorly in their third year or second year, they teach data structure and algorithms in their fourth semester, I guess, or third semester. These are different for different colleges. So for computer science guy, you are learning DSA in data structure only in third semester. So for the first semester, you get to introduce with the like languages like C and C++ maybe.
Mm-hmm.
So once you have that C and C++ in mind, you get a language for the implementation. So that is most generally used is C++.
Mm.
So once you get that language, you want to apply that into the data structure. You want to implement data structure with the help of that. So that's why the most of the college teaches data structures in third semester, and in fourth semester they teach algorithms.
Mm.
So that in the upcoming days you can combine this both two. So data and data structure and algorithm, don't think as this two separate, they are same thing. But this to the largeness of this, like, you know, course, it's separated into between two semesters.
So
the most thing is you start understanding the what are the core concept, like, you know, how the linked list is working, how the trees are, you know, working, what are the difference between graphs and trees, and like at the end the thing is you need to understand that for which problem you have to apply which data structure and what algorithm should you use at the end. Mm-hmm. This is the main goal. So the thing is, when you are starting with, for a computer science student, it's already started right in your course, and you have a still good part to go.
Yeah.
After that, you get that there are various platforms, like, you know, first of all is Geeks or Geeks, because this website helped me out a lot. So I am going to talk about it first. So Geeks or Geeks is a Bible for computer science student. Every people searching on the net, the first solution you'll be getting is for Geeks, I guess.
Yeah.
So this is the one thing. So Geeks of Geeks have recently introduced, you know, this courses as well as they have some practice set. So they have very good structure of this, you know, basic, difficult, medium difficulty, and hard, this kind of things, right? So once you gain that, so you have a pretty much a basic understanding while you're in college. You studied data structure and you studied algorithm in the fourth semester. So you have a basic understanding of this. So once you gain that and you come to Geeks or Geeks and start applying that knowledge, start from the basic. It doesn't need to be like go to hard and start applying to the hard problems, right? So go to Geeks or Geeks or any other platform like LeetCode. There is HackerRank. There is lots of platform like CodeSafe, CodeForces. But this also is a debatable topic, because CodeFaces is bit of hard side,
okay,
and code is also a bit of hard side.
Hmm.
So, you know, interview.
What do you think about HackerRank?
HackerRank is pretty good, actually. Hmm. So you have that gold, that stars, they gave stars on the basis of that.
Yeah.
So there is a track known as problem solving, I guess, in the HackerRank.
Yeah.
So up to fifth star, according to my experience. So up to fifth star, it's pretty good, actually. You will get to learn so many things. But again, for HackerRank, they have like problem statement superly bold out there, right? They give this input output. So for beginner, it is a bit difficult, hard to understand.
Okay.
For understanding that only, you know, you have to see lots of video. There is no, you know, this particular course, you take this course and you'll be good to go in data structure and algorithm.
Mm-hmm.
So for that, you have to, you know, self, you know, research about it, like where to go. There are lots of YouTube video. Again, you go to some other platform, you see there, then you will start connecting things, like, okay, this was here and this was here, and you start connecting things. Then once you have that intuition of connecting things, you go to HackerRank and Geeks or Geeks and start doing problems. Mm-hmm. Even if you're not able to solve, you start doing, like, you know, basic to advanced. And main thing is here, you know, talking to others, like there might be like someone who is good in it, and you should like definitely ask him or her that, yeah, you can you teach me, or you can give me basic idea about this is, because everyone have a different journey. But I will suggest, like, you know, ask your immediate seniors of your college, because your college have certain sets of syllabus, certain sets of curriculum. So your senior have already faced it, this one.
But yeah.
Yeah. So the most thing is, I would suggest ask your, you know, seniors who is doing good in this field of data structure algorithm. But again, like it's a very vast topic. Start with Geeks or Geeks or LeetCode. Start with basic and move on to advanced level. Once you go there, once you start, you'll able to understand your things yourself. First, it will be difficult, then eventually it will make sense.
All right.
Yeah.
And one question that a lot of first year students ask me is that, should I start learning DSA and, you know, just data structures and types of algorithms in my first year itself? And, you know, there are a few YouTubers online that say that you should, You should start from the first year itself, make sure that you are amazing at it, and only then do other things like development and software development and other things. What do you think about this?
According to me, like if you have done C or C++ in your 12th, like nowadays it's heavily introduced in the school syllabus as well. So if you have grasps of C++, so C++ not only going to the side of writing friend function or loops or anything, explore more side of C++, or even if you're doing in Java or any other language, there are something known as standard template library, STL, mm-hmm. or in Java, there are other library as well. Explore them as well. So if you're already good at it, for the first semester, at least explore them, because in the school level, I don't think they teach STL or these sort of things, mm-hmm. or Java, they teach this like libraries, like which have state maps and everything.
Yeah.
So for the first 6 months where you are, when you join college for the first 6 months or the next 6 months in first or second semester, you should definitely try out these libraries, and you know, they just import it and use it in your code. So you will understand that without implementing stack, you can use stack actually. Mm-hmm. So you know, you will get intuition. Okay, I'm using stack. So now I have used stack. Now you get intuition that how this stack is working, how the top, there are various terms like in queue also, like left, right, how these terms are implemented. Once you use stack, then move on to like data structure in second semester as well. You can start definitely in the first year. It's mm-hmm. good to start, but again, not everyone have like 12 done C++ or Java in their 12th grade. So mm-hmm. you can start, but it's better to like give a release to first year and then move on to like, you know, data structure and yeah. algorithms.
Mm-hmm. All right. One question is that should we really focus a lot on CGPA, and how important is CGPA for placements? And if you would mind, you can also tell your own CGPA if you want to.
I was pretty good at studies actually. My CGPA is pretty good. Like I don't want to like people demotivate people a lot, but I don't used to study a lot, but mm-hmm. I used to study like week before the exams, but yeah. I had pretty good 9+ CGPA, but that doesn't mean that, you know, you can't get a job with 7 CGPA. So if you go to like, you know, culture, like Silicon Valley or this company, Silicon Valley or this countries, USA and all, like in outer countries, what happens is, you know, they focus on skills, like, you know, somebody is doing this, he have done or she has done this, so he can do that in my company as well. So this is the thing that differentiate out here and there. So this is one of the thing.
I hope that sort of culture comes into India as well, so that they don't just focus merely on CGPA and cut. They have the CGPA cutoff, right? So it's like 7 CGPA. If you are below that, then we won't even talk to you. So yeah. All right.
Yeah, so, but like in colleges, it also going like, you know, like you, but the main thing is, you know, if anybody don't having 7 CGPA, like nobody is expecting him to do their job actually, because they can like nowadays, like syllabus is a bit easy only. So once you have fundamental clears, you can easily score like, you know, 6 or 7 CGPA. Mm-hmm. So just have that, you know, that baseline, that above this baseline, you can sit for the placements, right? So you just have that. If your baseline is 7, you can either have 7.25 or 8, anything upper than that. Mm-hmm. Just have that baseline. It doesn't need to be like, you know, 10 or anything, right? So just cross that baseline and you're good to go.
Yeah.
You explore other skills as well.
It's really sad in our college, you know. Yeah, Pittsburgh has a really strict grading policy. So it's like very few people get above 9 CGPA. And it's like, most of the people get very less CGPA. So we're just having a very hard time right now, even in the online mode. All right. Now, one more question that people ask is the importance of projects, and should they go into learning web development, Android development, and would it really make much of a difference when they would put that into their CV? What do you think about this?
So for that, like I was working on that only, like for my YouTube channel. I have a YouTube channel.
Yeah.
So for that, like for that only, like I was working on this topic only, like what are the important things? Okay, I revealed my next topic for YouTube, but that's fine. How projects are important, like so things like, you know, project. So based on me, like I started, suppose, learning, you know, you talked about web development and Android or anything, right? Mm-hmm. So So take example of web development, right? So web development, you have HTML, you have CSS, you have JavaScript. These are the base anybody starts with when start with like web development, right?
Yeah.
So when I start with HTML, I learn the basics, like I learn the fundamentals. What happens next? I go to CSS, I learn CSS, I learn some advanced CSS. What happens next? I go to JS, I learn JS. What happens next? If I don't apply React. To them, React. This goes on.
Yeah. But
the main thing is projects. So I just learn, like, suppose let's take a topic. So people don't knowing HTML, don't know HTML. I give you an example. There's a tag, suppose table tag. So what it does, it gives a table in HTML. So I learn table, right? I saw the course. What are the rows? What rows means, what column means. I saw the video. If I will not apply that in my project or neither I type them in my like code editor, I'll try myself. I'll definitely forget that in next 3 days.
Yeah.
I can guarantee that. There was a time like when I was learning React. So what I did was I learned only 2 days like of React. I gained some fundamental and I started applying to them to projects. So that learning and the learning I get from, you know, I did the course and left it. I never touched that like on other skills. I never I learned HTML, I left it. And I run React 2 days and applied to the project. So that learning is totally different. So once you start doing projects, when you start typing, you get to understand that, yeah, you have not understood that concept really well.
Yeah.
So, you know, you start searching thing, you go to Stack Overflow, you know, you get into problems. Okay. This is not working. Why it is working. This is the thing.
Yeah.
So you go to Stack Overflow and other places, you search for a solution. Okay. This is the solution. This was the thing I was doing wrong. So I need to be like good in this. I'm lagging in this portion of behind. So if you are lagging in this portion behind, you can again watch the courses. So anybody taking online course, so they have different learning skills. Like everybody learns different way, but the most prominent, like good way to do it, you watch the video, you leave it behind. Like you don't just, you know, you are watching video and you are copying the code that instructor is telling. You just watch the video once. Again, once you watch, you leave it behind. You try to implement that thing on your own. So in that nutrition, you learn the best. And again, after learning from the course, you skip the course separate. You leave the course, you start building projects. Like where you can get projects, you can get on dev.to. Dev.to is a site for developer community.
Yeah, yeah, or I've used that, the practical dev.
Yep. So you can directly search on like Google as well. Like what are the projects I can do as a beginner in React or HTML or CSS, anything. You can get tons of projects. Pick up that one and start doing it like on sale, write your own code. Again, somebody have written code for that as well, right? You know, so once you have that, your code and their code, you can compare at the last. Okay, these are the things I can do better. So this way, you know, get intuitive ideas about projects and, you know, things like how it is done.
I completely agree with that point, because even for me, back in July of this year, I took up this course on Udemy on React. I watched it for 3 days. I understood basically what React is, what are components, what are functional components. Then I just went into a project, not knowing exactly how to do it, and just took a look at how the person is building it, and then started making it on my own. I think that's the best approach to learning any technology.
So I also want to add a point here, like, you know, while instructor is teaching, this is like, you know, I have learned recently, once the instructor teaches, so instructor cannot teach like everything on the like that particular technology. So they pick up things from the documentation or any blogs to teach people, right? So once you have some like concept, suppose there is a X concept that instructor taught you, so related to that X concept, there are lots of things behind that X concept. So you can go to the documentation. For example, you're learning React. So some instructor teaches you some concept. So you can, after learning that concept, you can also go to the documentation and see what are the things that instructor have not taught, because like nobody can teach everything.
Yeah.
So that's one of the things.
That's true. That's really important. Being patient, I think, is really important, because most people just take look at videos and don't focus on the documentation because they don't like to read. And that's when they miss out on a lot of information.
Yeah.
All right.
Recommendation is also super important.
Yeah, exactly. One more question is, how has your experience been like so far working at Microsoft?
Oh, it's pretty good. Like it's one of the best experience so far. Like, you know, after mm-hmm. college, it's like not joining a company. It's like joining a community.
Mm-hmm.
Like people are so helpful here. Like, you know, so I, there are people who do different stuff, like their hobbies and as well, apart from work. So you work here. After working, you know, you do whatever you like. They are ready to support you, you know.
Mm.
So in work also, you have any doubt, you just ping them. You get the reply definitely. So that's one of the best thing I have explored. And one of the thing is, you know, everybody have, you know, different passions. So they can follow along with the work. It's not about, you know, you are working and, you know, you can do other things as well. So I do YouTube. I recently discovered one of my favorite hobbies, like filmmaking. I started mm-hmm. learning filmmaking. So apart from work, you can also do anything. Like it's not a company, it's actually a community. I really like working a lot. And also in this pandemic, they have like, you know, very good programs going on. You know, people are, you know, working from home, and they have pretty much everybody have different environment. So they have also provided like, you know, this monitor setup, this ergonomical chair. So they have like pretty good, so they have pretty good idea behind this, you know. So they have idea of productivity. So until and unless you have in the productive environment, the things you get that makes you productive, it's super good. They will give you like,
mm-hmm.
so this is one of the best thing. And everybody is really supportive, and you know, you can talk to your managers regarding everything, be your personal stuff, be your professional stuff. You can talk everything. They are ready to help you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, it was great talking to you. And guys, if you have any questions, you can reach out to him on his Instagram account. I'm also linking his own YouTube channel in the description. So go take a look at that. And Rohan, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. And also, you can connect me on LinkedIn. I'm pretty much active on these three, YouTube, LinkedIn, and Instagram. Any doubt,
you can find the link in the description for that too.
Yeah. And you're really doing a like great job. I am learning from you a lot, like that book things, like, you know, you read a lot of books. So I saw like videos of yours, like really doing great. I learned daily from you. Like, keep doing
thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Yeah.